Hi, and welcome to another episode of Tom Kennedy's Science. I'm your host, Dr. Tom Kennedy. Now, today is my first part of a series on cells. And you know, if you're going to start talking about cells, you almost always start with the prokaryotes. You know, those smaller, kind of structurally simple cells. Now, what I want to focus on today is a little bit on cell theory. That'll be the least amount. But then I also want to talk about, why do cells have so many features in common? I mean, we're talking animal cells all the way down to simple bacteria share many things in common. Why is that? And I'll give you a hint. It has to do with evolution. And then I want to talk about the importance of cells, you know, both for us, like in our gut microbiome, but also to the world around us today, and also from an evolutionary point of view. I mean, the world has been drastically changed because of bacteria. And then I want to talk about some of the key evolutionary innovations they've had, because that's pretty awesome stuff. And then, you know, bacteria, not only they had a profound effect on this world, they also are everywhere. And I want to talk about like how bacteria are literally everywhere on this planet. And then how studying bacteria around the planet, how we can do that to understand how we might find life living on another planet like Mars, or even better yet, a moon. I know, I think it's crazy, but moons might be a better shot at finding life than another planet in our solar system anyways. And lastly, what I'll talk about will be the parts of prokaryotic cells. So let's get started right now. Cell theory, very straightforward. Cells are the basic unit of life. And on this picture, I've got a scanning electron microscope photo of cells in our gut microbiome. And of course, this has been colorized so you can see all the bacteria. Life on this planet is made of cells because, you know, life is an emergent property of a complex system, right? So the system is the cell, and it's the smallest thing that has all these processes of life. So whether or not you're a bacteria, the larger, more complex eukaryotic cell, or an animal cell, that's still, even multicellular organisms like us are made up of cells. And then here's my little natural history. That's a dragonfly. You know, dragonflies are really amazing. And we often think of like, what are the greatest predators on the planet? You're probably thinking something like great white shark, cheetah. Guess what? It's these guys, these dragonflies. They have a kill rate of almost 90 to 95%. That's how successful they are when they go out after a mosquito or something. And dragonflies have been on this planet for over 325 million years. They've been hardly changed at all since. I mean, nature got it right with the dragonfly. So it's kind of cool. I like to show this one off. This one, of course, is from New Mexico. But cell theory, basically all life is made up of cells, whether you're a multicellular organism or not. And then in today's world, all cells come from pre-existing cells. So there's no new cells just arising spontaneously or through abiogenesis on our planet. Now, that's not always been the case. You go back to about 3.8, 4.0 billion years ago, and life did emerge through abiogenesis. Now, abiogenesis, A means without, bio means life, and genesis means origin. So the word abiogenesis means the origins of life from non-living material. So we have good evidence that life got started at least 3.8 billion years ago. We have the fossil remains of stromatolites, which are these bacterial colonies. Now, interestingly, all life on this planet came from a single common ancestor. Now, I'm not talking about one cell or one organism, but a population of cells that arose probably in some hydrothermal vent in an ancient ocean probably 4 billion years ago. And we call it LUCA, the last universal common ancestor. And you can see this phylogeny, that's a relationship of life on this planet. And you'll notice there's three major parts to it. Two of those major parts are the prokaryotes. Pro just means before, and kary means like the kernel. So like it's got before the kernel, so they don't have a nucleus. And of course, the two domains of life that are prokaryotes are the bacteria and the archaean. And then the eukaryotes, we're weird. All multicellular life, plants, animals, fungus, are made up of eukaryotic cells. and they form from the merger. Oh, I'm getting ahead of myself. I get so excited. Two prokaryotes merged. I gave away something, but I can't help myself. But that's the third domain of life, is the eukarya. So as a result of sharing common ancestry, you can imagine that all life shares certain features in common. One of them, as you learned in the previous chapters, about plasma membranes. These form a barrier around a cell, and they have, of course, selective permeability that regulates what comes in and out of the cell. So the interior of a cell is different from its exterior. So all life is, or at least all cells, are surrounded by some type of plasma membrane. I got a little distracted. There's some birds coming into my feeder here. Now, inside the cell, we also have what is called the cytoplasm. And in the cytoplasm, this is where all the chemistry of life takes place. I know, isn't that amazing? It's all this waters and minerals and building blocks of life and enzymes floating around and things like ribosomes. And all life makes proteins using this molecular structure called a ribosome, which we're going to go into much more detail about. But ribosomes are made up of both RNA and proteins. And it's the RNA that actually puts the amino acids together to make a protein. Now, you guys already know this. Life uses the same 20 amino acids to make every protein. So there are millions of proteins throughout the world. And guess what? They're all made by basically using the same 20 amino acids put together in the ribosomes. And then, you know, if you're using the same building blocks to make proteins, well, the information to store that is in our DNA. So all life uses DNA, adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine, right? And not only do we use DNA and RNA, RNA is turning out to be this incredibly versatile molecule, much like a protein, because it can form complex 3D structures. Pretty cool. But I digress. Not only do we use the same four nucleotides, but the genetic code is the same. Think about that. I can take a protein in a human, let's say to make insulin. I can extract that protein, and then I can put it in a bacterium. Guess what? The bacteria will make human insulin. And in fact, that's how we made our first insulin to save diabetics. So this, of course, I'm showing you is the RNA genetic code, and that is nearly universal for every living organism on this planet. So that evolved one time. That's been inherited for like 3.8 billion years unchanged. Now, it gets even better than that. I know, we got the same amino acids, we use the same genetic code, but guess what? There's even more. There's even more. We share hundreds of genes. All life on this planet shares hundreds of genes. So if you're sharing hundreds of genes, you've got all these proteins in common. And in fact, not only do we just make the same proteins or very similar, or actually they are kind of the same proteins, we also share metabolic processes with every living organism on this planet. So you and I, we do glycolysis to break down glucose, something we'll learn about, into something called pyruvate. And it's an 11-step process. All life does it. All life uses the same exact enzymes to do that. Same with the Krebs cycle, as shown here on your right. It's a metabolic process. It's a series of chemical reactions that you need an enzyme to carry out. So all life makes those same enzymes. So once again, we didn't evolve this independently. We did this, we inherited this from our common ancestor. Now we have this tendency to think of prokaryotes as primitive, but they're not. And in fact, they have a short generation time. I mean, there are bacteria that might have a generation time of 20 minutes. And you think about over a course of like 3.8 billion years, that's a lot of generations. So bacteria evolve rather quickly. They also shed genes rather quickly, but they evolve rather quickly, and they can easily adapt to a changing environment. Of course, I've got South Park here drawn as the Simpsons, because these guys that do South Park, they were making an episode and the writers kept saying, Simpsons did it. Simpsons did it first. Simpsons did it first. Reminds me of bacteria and archaea, the prokaryotes. They did almost everything first, except one exception. No multicellular life, only eukaryotes did that. But what did they do first? Let's take a look. Prokaryotes, what do you think they did? How about photosynthesis? No plant ever evolved photosynthesis. Nope. They acquired it from cyanobacteria. So photosynthesis first evolved about 3 billion years ago. This was a huge evolutionary innovation for many reasons. In fact, other than the copying of DNA, this might be one of the biggest evolutionary leap forwards for life on this planet. And the reason why is because photosynthesis can take the energy in sunlight and use it to take carbon dioxide and water and make carbohydrates. And it makes carbon in our elements available to us and a lot of energy. And the evolution of photosynthesis, as you know, releases oxygen into the atmosphere as well. Now, putting the oxygen into the atmosphere was huge because it changed the planet, right? Oxygen oxidized everything around it, but oxygen really and truly, it energized life. And over billions of years, oxygen levels began to slowly rise in the atmosphere. And guess what? Bacteria responded again. And in this case, they evolved the ability to do, and of course, bacteria evolved the ability to use aerobic respiration. And that's using oxygen to break down organic molecules, and they make a lot more ATP. So there's two key evolutionary innovations done by prokaryotes that eukaryotes never did. And then, of course, the merger of two prokaryotes, an archaean and a bacteria, led to the origin of eukaryotic cells, the third domain of life. So pretty wild, isn't it? And that's through a process called endosymbiosis. I'll talk more about that in my second part. Okay, so today, bacteria are really important. You know, they're everywhere. And one of the most exciting fields in microbiology for a lot of you is how they interact with us, and specifically our gut microbiome. It has turned out that we have thousands of different types of bacteria that live in and on humans. And these gut microbiomes are strongly influenced by your genetics, where you live, what you eat, and who you live with. And there are, of course, good gut bacteria, and there are ones that are not so good for us. And they affect everything from our health, rates of obesity and metabolic syndrome, to even our mood and our cravings. I know, it's amazing. These bacteria can communicate with us and let us know what they need sometimes, for good or bad. And of course, a lot of human suffering is caused by bacteria that cause diseases. And because bacteria are known to cause diseases, people often think of, we got to kill all the germs around us. And the idea is you don't need to do that. And in fact, bacteria, while many of them are just neutral to us, there are good bacteria that we do need as part of our diet and living with us. Now, in addition to bacteria being important for humans, directly as our gut microbiome, they're also incredibly important for ecological functions as well. They are decomposers, breaking down organic material and allowing those nutrients to be recycled in the environment. They also do other things like they can fix nitrogen out of the atmosphere, and plants need nitrogen to grow as well. So that's just a couple different importance of bacteria. But, you know, one of the most interesting things, bacteria are everywhere. I mean, really, seriously, bacteria everywhere. You could go get a handful of dirt, and in that handful of dirt would be more people than have ever lived on this planet. I know. All right, here's another crazy stat for you. Bacteria are everywhere. You can take about a drop of seawater, a drop, and there could be millions of bacteria living in a drop of seawater. What are they doing? What are they doing there? How are they surviving? Why are there so many different species? I just want to know what these things are all doing and how they're all different from each other. I mean, they're just single cells, but yet there's lots of different types. So who are they? What are they doing? Turns out that bacteria everywhere, like I said, don't call them primitive. This is from Yellowstone. This water is incredibly hot. These are what we call thermophiles. Thermophiles can live in very hot environments. And you want to talk about the need for studying just random bacteria in a hot spring? Anybody ever done genetics? You ever extracted some DNA and amplified it? You use something called TAC polymerase, Thermus aquaticus. Back in the 1970s, these scientists were studying the bacteria in this here, and they realized these bacteria are living in 170 degree Fahrenheit water. And the proteins did not denature. So they realized that when the proteins aren't denaturing in this hot water, that they could extract the DNA polymerase from this thing to help amplify DNA during the PCR. And I think that that patent sold for hundreds of millions of dollars. So amazing, you know, just by studying some bacteria living in a hot spring, these people made bukus of money and revolutionized the way we can sequence DNA. So bacteria not only live in hot environments, they can live in very acidic environments, pH of 2, pH of 1. There are seriously bacteria that can live in battery acid. It's pretty crazy. Or you have these extremophiles called a psychrophile. They love it cold. So you can go to Antarctica where there's like, in some places, 2 miles of solid ice and there's lakes underneath there. Guess what you find growing? Bacteria. Bacteria living in these frozen lakes under 2 miles of ice. There's also the bacteria down there called litho-autotrophs. Litho means rock, auto means self, troph means feeding. These bacteria are literally extracting energy by eating rocks. Isn't that crazy? And in fact, you can go to the most frozen places of the Antarctic, called McMurdo Bay, and you can pull up the rocks, and there's actually bacteria living in those frozen rocks, the bottom of the planet. That's amazing. And in fact, when they discovered these, what they call endoliths, bacteria living in rock, back in the 1990s, scientists started getting really excited about the prospects of finding life elsewhere in the solar system. So where do you think we might find life in the solar system? Mars, anybody? Here's a quick rundown of why we might find life on Mars. It had water. It did have a thicker atmosphere. It still has water under the surface. Now, there's been methane detected. It doesn't need to come from life, but it can. But unfortunately, Mars is a dead planet. It's completely oxidized. We'll learn more about oxidation in a later lecture. It's red, which means that like an endolith would have a hard time living off of these rocks. There's clearly no photosynthesis there. It's not green. It's red from the oxidized minerals. So, and this planet also hasn't had water for, you know, several billion years. So that would make it hard for life to be on this planet. However, the Mars rover Perseverance is currently on Mars right now looking for signs of life on this planet. And in the 1990s, they found a meteor called the Allen Hills 84001, where some scientists think that these little fossils were of microbial life from Mars. That is debatable. All right, that's scientific controversy right there. Other places we might find life. The moon of Jupiter called Europa. And underneath it is a large ocean. And it's geologically active. It's being tugged by other moons between it and Jupiter, which have heated it up. And this moon might have life on it. This is, of course, showing the liquid ocean underneath that solid ice. Let's go further out. Enceladus is a small moon of Saturn. And once again, it's an ice ball. This moon is tiny. But because it's between a much larger moon, Titan, and Saturn, it's being tugged and it's being warmed up. And so it's got liquid underneath the ice. And in fact, not only did they find liquid underneath the ice, the Cassini probe actually took a picture of water spewing out of the ice and fissures. And that water had a very similar composition to water here on our planet. That is cool. And of course, one of the most strange places on the solar system outside of the Earth is this large moon called Titan. It has an atmosphere. It's got lakes and rivers and it rains, but not water. It rains and has a liquid hydrocarbons like methane and ethane on its surface, but it does have liquid. And liquid is very good for the chemistry of life. However, there's no liquid water. So if we found life on the surface of this moon, this may be a game changer in terms of how we think life may exist in the universe. Because right now, we think that most life will be in water, but a liquid hydrocarbon would be pretty crazy. And in fact, finding life on any place would be pretty amazing. And lastly, Venus. There are some people that think we might have life on Venus. There was a molecule that was found known to be made by living organisms. Venus may have been much more Earth-like up until about a billion years ago, and life could be hanging out in the water vapor in the clouds, just like they do on our planet. So we'll see. Outside of our solar system, you know, we're finding new planets. Like, the rate at which we discover planets is increasing, and we're doubling the number of known planets about every 2 years, a little over 2 years. Right now, we have about 165 terrestrial planets. And, you know, if we can find oxygen in the atmosphere of one of these planets, that would be pretty amazing. And these are some of the potentially habitable exoplanets. So we are really in a golden age of exploration here. All right. Now, that's the fun stuff. Now, I want to come back really quick and just talk very briefly about some of the features of prokaryotic cells. You know, they have a plasma membrane. They've got a single circular chromosome. They make proteins in the ribosomes. They have cytoplasm and the cell wall. Now, briefly, the cell wall is this tough fibrous thing on the outside of the membrane and allows the membrane to push up against it and for the cell to have pressure on the inside of it. And in a bacteria, it's made up mostly of something called peptidoglycan. And in archaeans, their cell wall is made up of very different types of molecules. The DNA inside of a bacteria is circular, and there's one chromosome. And that's very important when you guys get to genetics. But basically, every time a bacteria gets its DNA replicated, it replicates all of the DNA at once. Now, we've often thought that bacteria, prokaryotes in general, did not have internal cellular structures. It turns out they do. This is a type of photosynthetic bacteria. It clearly has internal membranes to increase surface area and create divisions within the cell so that it can do photosynthesis. And when we learn about photosynthesis, you can actually go to my videos on photosynthesis and learn about the light reaction, but this increases the amount of light reaction you can have inside the cell. And there's also sometimes they have little organelles as well, but mostly used for storage of like calcium or magnetite, so they can actually use that as a little magnet, little compass, so they know which way to go. And then of course, bacteria, some bacteria have flagella, which is a protein with a little motor on it that spins it so it'll move. They also have these things called frambrae. These are important structures because they allow some bacteria to attach very well to surfaces or to each other, and that has some implications for medicine, because you can get these biofilms in your laboratory that can be really hard to get rid of. And then, you know, we tend to think of cells as being kind of simple sometimes, but I love David Goodcell's illustrations. And in this illustration, he's showing all of the different types of molecules and cellular structures from the membrane, the cell wall, the flagella, the ribosomes, the chromosomes, right? And various other molecules inside the cell. And you can see very nicely that these things are really complex. And he actually has a book out called The Machinery of Life that I enjoyed reading. Okay, we managed to get through this. I hope everybody enjoyed this episode of Tom Kennedy Science. Until next time, it's been Tom Kennedy Science.